My name is Mr. Ashley McGlone. My mom liked Gone with the Wind, and so I wound up with a girl's name all my life. First piece of mail I ever received, 12 years old, was an invitation to the Miss Teen Ohio pageant. Got first runner up, though. First runner up. I would have had it if I shaved my legs. Okay. Yeah, the goatee, that's right. Yeah. That's right. Now, Lao Tzu, we opened with this quote. I told you last night I was over at Ed's house reading his ancient history books, and I found this quote from Lao Tzu. Give a man a script, feed him for a get date. Teach him how to script, feed him for a new dash time span. And we actually used that commandlet, didn't we?
Yep.
We sure did. All right, the objective of this session, we're going to bump it up a notch from 100 to 200, 300 level here. And now we're looking at PowerShell functions and modules. So this gives us a way to standardize and share our code. When we last left our PowerShell hero, he had just finished figuring out how to get the uptime on a machine and how to get the last date that a patch was installed. And that's where we left him, in this predicament. And now he's got to finish his job and put this into some functions and modules that he can share. That's where we're going to pick up. So why functions and modules? First off, let me see a show of hands. How many have ever written a PowerShell function? All right, how about a module? Oh, we got a few. All right. Yeah, of course you have. So why functions and modules? Why should we take the extra time once we've got our script? Because here's the temptation. You've got a script. It kind of works. Why not just leave it there? A lot of times that's where we stop, right? Hey, I finally got it. It kind of works. It's going to get the job done. I don't have time to put it into something a little more fancy. So here are some reasons. Number one, it's standardized code at that point. Standardized work. Back when I was writing VBScript for a large manufacturing company in North America, I had a folder out on my H drive that had hundreds and hundreds of VB scripts. And anytime I go to write a new one, I'd go to that folder first and copy what I had done sometime in the past and start off there. But now in PowerShell, what I can do is take those functions that I've created over time and just stash them all into a module. So I'm kind of over time building this module that has all these handy functions that I've already written, and I don't have to go find it, I don't have to copy and paste it, it's already there, and I can just go back to that library of functions I've stored in my module. It's reusable over and over and over. We can share it with others very easy. Now it makes our code portable. I can say, here's a module for you. Install this, go to help about modules, and it'll tell you exactly what to do with it, and there's help in the commandlets, and you can be self-service at that point. It also gives you some version control. So now in the manifest for the module, I can put in version numbers, and I can kind of begin to version it. So as I improve things and add features, add commands, I can upgrade the version number in there, and it gives me a little formal way to track that. And finally, it eliminates code signing hassles. This is not that common, but how many here have require signed code in production? Okay, we got a couple. I was working with a customer actually just the first week this year, and I was in this process of developing code, and they said, well, we can't run anything unless it's signed. And the way I had just templated the code, I hadn't got it into a module yet. The problem with just a flat script, if it's not parameterized, I've got to make changes to my variables instead of putting them into parameters that I can then pass in. So every time I have to change that script, I've got to re-sign it. And that's a real pain in the rear end. So it's easier to kind of template this thing now into form of a function or a module where we've got parameters in there and we don't have to sign it but just once. So those are some reasons why you might want to choose to put your code into a function or a module. Now, the scripting process, as we mentioned earlier, starts out with a big idea, something that you need to fix, a problem to solve. You go find the commandlets, you get in there, you figure out which commandlets are going to get me my information, I find the properties and methods I need to call. Then I take those and string them together into a pipeline that's going to sort and filter and output some other things, input, process, output on my pipeline. Then I'm going to script it. So I've got these things working at the console, proof of concept. I pull it into my script editor, and now I can start to build a PS1 file. And that's where we left off last time. The next step then is to take those snippets of script that we've put together that are kind of starting to get where we want to go with our script. We put those into functions then that we can call within our script over and over, and it just works. The example we used was prompting for a computer name, but we want to make sure it's a good one, so we're going to do a WMI call first to make sure it really works. And then we take that script, we put it into a function. Now we've got a collection of functions. We strip out all the calling code, we save that into a module file, and now we're cooking with gas. We got something we can share with our team. And after you've done that a time or two, before you know it, you will be the scripting hero on your team. Do you really want to be that person on the team? I think so. I think it's going to work better for you in the long run. You know. So, functions. These are reusable sections of script. They standardize procedures and logic. Typically, there's some kind of magic or foo that you put into a function that you have to, you know, manipulate that data in some way, or you know, massage it to return a certain piece of it. And so that's what we're using a function for, kind of one thing at a time. We call it atomic. It's supposed to return one thing. And then it's usually a single task, usually parameterized. So I'm going to pass in a couple parameters, get something out. And again, we can use snippets in the console, Control J. I would tell you to write that down, but it's on the screen. You can remember that, Control J and the ISE. And so there are a bunch of help topics for that. And the example we used was prompting for a computer name. Finally, modules then. We have a different file extension. It's PSM1, and that is a collection of PowerShell functions in a text file, just like your PS1 file. The only difference is it's just the functions. It's not all the other code that goes under the functions. And then we can optionally create a metadata manifest file, what's called a PSD1, and then we share that with our team. And it gives you a portable code library. So you just say, import my module, and it's all there for you. And we use the examples of maybe a collection of help desk solution scripts would be a good thing to bundle up, put a bow on it, and call it the help desk module. So now that we've got through the PowerPoint, let's get to the PowerShell. Okay, so if you have a laptop, pull it out, and we can play with this code together. You can go download it from the blog address at the top of the slides there, aka.ms/gotpfe. And we'll pick this up where we left off now. And as usual, I would like your input to make this successful. So, we last left our PowerShell hero out here. He's got some code that will create a computer name that's been validated as a parameter, and he's got some code that'll go grab the uptime of a box and some code that'll get the last patch that was installed. So that's what we've got. So now what we want to do is put those into a function, and I'm going to open up a new script pane here. I'm going to copy this, open it up in a new window, paste. I'm almost done. All right, so now I'm going to come up to the top. What was that shortcut key? Control J. Oh, you guys are awesome. Control J. And here we go. I've got an advanced function complete. Let's see if we got just function. Yeah, there's a function, just a basic function right there. So there, I just inserted a template for a basic function. Now I'm going to go cut and paste my code and put it inside. Actually, it'd be easier just to move this one curly brace right here. That'd be faster. And then because I'm a neat freak, I'm going to tab that in, make it look, you know, it's inside of indentation there. And my params up here, I like to put them, I'll just leave it that way for now. And we're going to call this, actually in this case we don't really need params. I'll just leave that empty. And what do you think would be a good name for this function? Get valid computer name. All right, do you want to type all that every time? I'm messing with you. All right, yeah. Right, tab complete, very good. So here we go, get dash. Now, valid computer name. What if I don't, we're gonna create a lot of functions over our life as a PowerShell programmer. I'll use the programmer word. We're not a programmer, we're a scripter. So I wanna show you one little trick here, get dash verb. I'm gonna pipe that to more. Get dash verb will give you a list of suggested verbs to use in your functions. And they're even categorized here. Common, data, lifecycle, diagnostic, security, other. So those are suggested verbs. So if you need some creativity, some help naming your function, start with get dash verb. So over here then, we're going to do a get dash valid computer name. And I'm going to run this code. Let me clear my output with the squeegee. Now, all right, I ran the code. It didn't do anything, though. I got to call it, right? I got to do that, too. You're both on to me. All right. So now I'm going to call get dash valid. Oh, wow. Look at that. IntelliSense has my stuff in it. Nice. Get dash valid computer name. So I'm going to run just that one line using the run one line button up here. Enter the name of the machine to target. We did ASDF and we determined that was not a valid computer name, just a test. All right, it's timing out, trying to find that machine. CVDC1 should be valid. And it comes back, but there's a problem. It didn't give me any output, actually. It didn't return a value. And in functions, programming languages, you may have used the keyword return to return a value. That's optional in PowerShell. I'm just going to put here dollar computer name. I could put return in front of it, but it's really not necessary. So that's going to be my output. Now I'm going to run this. It's going to redefine the function and call it again. Enter the name of a machine to target, CVDC1. And it comes back and puts the output here, CVDC1. All right, so that's the output I'm looking for from my function. That's the magic coming back. Now I want to capture this into a variable. So we'll say $goodComputer equals getValidComputerName. I probably should save that. So let's call this most amazing script ever. All right. And so now I've got a script that's going to call a function, get computer. Now, here's the thing. Now I know when I give this to somebody to run it. See, the first time I published my script to the people that were using this, they said, hey, we ran this and it had all kinds of red text on the screen. What's that mean? Well, red text, that's what I call a learning moment in PowerShell. You need to read it and study, learn some more so you can get rid of that red text. By the way, quick trivia question. The only person in the world that never gets red text in their PowerShell console? Chuck Norris. All right. Now we've got a couple other functions here that we were working on earlier. If I find those. Here's one for uptime. I want a function called get-uptime. Now, here's one other rule of thumb in PowerShell. when you declare your functions, they go at the top of the script. In some languages, you can put them at the bottom, but not in PowerShell. It has to go top down. So if you have a function that calls another function, it must be located above in the script. That's your general rule of thumb.
Anywhere above.
Yep.
Single pass. What was the purpose of the variable?
Well, we're typically... Actually, can you just hold that thought?
Okay.
So now I'm going to create a new function here. And because I used Control J earlier, I'm going to do that again. Fun, there it is. Put the fun in function. All right. Now I'm going to do a function called get-uptime. And I'm going to move my code inside that function. Boop. And then I'm going to tab it in. And I'm going to put a param in here. Dollar computer name. And down here in my code, and this is slightly different than what we did earlier, I'm going to return uptime. Actually, I don't have to put that in there. I'll just do it as total days here. So this is code we already cooked up earlier. Remember Bobby Flay? We brought it out of the oven. It was all ready to go. So here, then, I've got this. It's bringing back the total days property of that difference between today's date and the last boot time. So that's what we're working with. And I've got my computer name variable in here. So what happens when you create a parameter in a script, what it will do is it treats it, you can make it whatever you want it to be. So if you imagine writing a commandlet, get dash something, and then you got a dash parameter after it, that's what the parameter is here. So we're going to call it with this dash, whatever name you give it. That's the parameter. And so in this case, we're returning this value. It just dumps it out. But I have to put a computer name in there. Now, what would happen if somebody called this without specifying a computer name?
Red text.
Learning moment. Right. So we probably should enforce it and tell it this is a mandatory parameter, because we don't want an empty one. And there's a way we can do that. In help, let me flip back to my console here. I usually have two windows open. This is about learning the scripting process. I usually have a console where I'm testing things, trying things, looking at help, and then I've got my script window where I'm actually doing the stuff. So in this case, I want to find some help on functions, help about underscore fun. And here we go. We got functions, functions advanced, functions advanced methods, and functions advanced parameters. So help about functions about blah, blah, blah. I don't have to put the whole thing in there, just enough to make it unique. Dash show window. And here it is, about functions advanced parameters. And in here it's going to show us that right here we can specify mandatory arguments. So I'm going to copy this straight out of the help because I'm too lazy to type it. Copy, paste. Actually, look, that's just like what we want to do, isn't it? Let's just copy the whole thing. What do you say? I didn't even plan that, man. So we'll just put this whole thing right here. Oh, man, it's making me look like a real scripter now. Shift-Tab to get it back to the left margin there. So now I've got a get uptime function with a parameter dash computer name. And what I'm going to do is put a call to it down here. Get dash, hold on, uptime, that was it. Uptime. And it even tab completes. I've not even ran the code yet. I love this new ISE. Get dash uptime dash. Oh, there's my parameter. I just made that. Nice. Dollar computer name that I just got from the prompted user. All right. So now we're going to prompt for a valid computer name and enforce that. And then we're going to pass that computer name then into our get uptime function.
Wouldn't it be a computer?
Dollar Good Computer. I'm glad you are watching and paying attention, because I'm not. That's your job. Keep me straight. Okay, here we go. We're going to run this script now. So it's going to prompt, enter the name of a machine to target. Give me the victim. CVDC1. Oh, right on. Yeah. There's the uptime for that machine in days. And that's all made possible by the magic of fun functions in PowerShell. All right? Yes?
When you use the script control J to get your snippet and put in the function or two parameters in parentheses that you got rid of, does it matter? What's the difference between putting the parameters in those parentheses versus down below like you ended up with?
When I was growing up, we had this turn of phrase that's more than one way to skin a cat.
Okay.
I've never skinned a cat. I have to admit that. But there's more than one way to do things in PowerShell also. And so here we got the param, and that param block can go in a couple different places.
Okay.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Nope. And you can look up about functions, and it'll give you that example syntax and the help.
So you can still make it mandatory in the parens after the
function. Yeah. So the last thing was a function. I tell you what, I want to skip ahead because I want to be conscious of our time. The other thing that I need to do here is now if I come down here to the console and I type help, it actually knows that I've got a function get uptime. And to show you what this looks like on this really tiny 1024 screen, here it actually shows me help on my command. Nice. It's like help for what I just wrote. It's got a computer name parameter and everything. This is starting to look like real PowerShell now. So what's missing, though? All the other help content, right? If I type update help, it doesn't know where to find anything about get-uptime. So I got to write my own help. And the way we do that, can anybody guess what shortcut key I'm going to use? Control-J. Good. All right, so here we go. I'm going to put it somewhere up here around the top of my function. It can go above it. It can go right under it. It can go into the param. Just has to be somewhere here in the function. Control. Actually, hold on. It's going to give us a lot of extra stuff we don't maybe want. Let me come down here at the bottom. Control. Oh, what am I? There we go. Okay. And I'm going to insert this right here. Maybe. My machine's acting up. There we go. So it basically dumps out this advanced function format for me. The only piece of this template that I want to keep is this little funny looking comment block. So I'm going to cut that out, ditch the rest of it, and come back up here and paste this in. So now I've got a short description, gets uptime from a computer, long description, calculates, there's no spell check here, calculates uptime by subtracting boot time from now. An example would be get-uptime-computer-name, Jimmy's World Domination Machine. All right, there we go. So now I've got some help in there. I can also do this dot parameter, which there's a couple ways to do this too. And I can say I've got a computer name parameter. Computer name. Whoops, that goes right here. And this is going to be the victim in question. All right, so now I save that. I run my. I'm going to just run this piece to declare that function again. It just puts that function in memory. And now when I type help, get-uptime. Hey, look. We're looking fancy. We got our own synopsis, our description. But wait a minute, we put some examples. Where did the examples go? Get help dash full, or let's take it one step further. Let's do help get uptime show window. Oh, look at that. Touchdown, Seahawks. So there we go. We've got the computer name parameter. Is it required? That's true. This looks like real PowerShell help now. And all it took was a couple green comments at the top of my function. Now, I know this has never happened at your company, but I've been told that in some places there are developers or scripters who will come in on a temporary contract, write a bunch of stuff, and leave and not document any of it. Now, I know you've never done that. It's never happened to you, but don't be that guy. You need to put help in your stuff because you know what? Who are they going to call if they can't figure it out? They're going to call you. You're the one that wrote it. So you need to put good help in here so you can get other stuff done in the week.
Hopefully all right? They haven't disconnected their phone lines.
All right. Yep, so here we go. Now I've got an example down here with Jimmy's World Domination Machine. I've got my uptime, my parameters. Hey, we are writing real PowerShell here. And what did it? Was it really that complicated? Control J. It couldn't be easier, right? So here we go. Well, I'm going to take a look now. How can I put this? I've created some functions. I put some documentation in those functions now. And now I want to share them as a module. So that sounds difficult. It's not that difficult. And the help's going to tell you exactly what you need to know. So if we look at get help, hope you're picking that up. I type get help a lot. All right, get help, star module star. Let's see what we've got. New module. I'm looking for this right here, about modules. And I'm just going to copy that because I'm lazy to type. Help, right click, paste, about modules, show window. And here it is, it built in, out of the box, free help. I didn't have to go read somebody's blog, didn't have to buy somebody's book. It's built in, okay? All kinds of help right here for you. But here's a little secret. The people that write the books and blogs that tell you how to use PowerShell, where do they get their answers? It's right here. You now have the inside track. You know how to know what they know. Exactly. I wouldn't say copy and paste, but you could write a book with that. It might have worked in college, but you don't want to try that here. So there we go. All the help we want on how to do a module. So let's come back and visit our script. Another Bobby Flay moment here. Let's fast forward in the demo. We've got some functions written here. Get last patch takes a parameter of computer name. So now in this one, I actually put in a parameter for uptime. I told it, let's pick units, days or hours. And then I've got a little switch here that says return total days or total hours. So we even fancied that up a little bit. So I've got these into functions. And now what I want to do, I'm going to flip on through here to 10. So this is kind of what our module file is going to look like now. We've got some functions. We've got help in there for each one of them. Get dash uptime. We've got some parameters declared. And I know there's some extra fancy stuff in there, but that's all in the help text. Again, about underscore functions. It'll get you there. And then get last patch. I put my help in there. Boy, whoever wrote this should be given an award for documentation. Remember that, documentation. All right, so here we go. Now what I've done, I gave you a little bonus in the online version of this. There's a report, a get-report commandlet, which takes all of this and runs it for me now. So I can take a parameter of a servers in a list of a text file. It's going to create a report. And for each server in that text file, it's going to collect data from that machine. Then we're going to check to see if it's online, and if it is, then we're going to call our uptime, get-uptime, and get-last-patch. In this case, because our original spec said we had to do it either from a one-off, just a single computer, or from a list of computers. So that's all there. So I realize I fast-forwarded a little bit, but I want to backtrack now and show you how to do that. So we want to take our most amazing script ever, and we want to convert this into a module. The main difference is two things. We've already written the functions. We put some help in there, and they work. All we do is we go to the bottom of the script where we had code that called the functions, and we delete that part at the bottom. And then we save it with a different file extension, PSM1. That's it. And we have a module. Here we go. I'm going to delete this stuff at the bottom. Do a save as most amazing script ever, PSM1. Quick change. Done. We just wrote a module. All right. Yeah. So we're done with the class now, I guess. Yeah, so this is the most amazing module. Question.
Are there any performance implications on how many functions you put within a module?
Not that I'm aware of. Good question. No, I'm not aware of any performance limitations with stacking up 40 million functions in one module.
So you have help for each one of the functions. Is there help for an entire module?
Yes. You can, when you import a module, the question is there help for a whole module? You can do help for a function, but what about the whole module? For example, when you import the Active Directory module, it actually imports some of those about underscore help topics with it. I've never done that with my own modules, but I'm sure it's documented in that about module somewhere, how to build your own help topics that are imported at the same time.
About my module, I guess.
Yeah, something like that. You would create a file. I've not done it. I'd have to look that up. But yes, you can build in additional help topics that come in as those conceptual abouts. All right, so now let's keep moving here. I'm watching the clock. We want to take this module and reference it. So I'm going to come out here. Now let's see, where did we save that file? We're out here. Here. Nope. So I'm going to go to, I want to cheat, file, save as, and I'm just going to copy the path here. And then I'm going to come out here. I'm going to launch a brand new PowerShell console. Nothing up my sleeve. And I'm going to change into that directory. dir*.psm1. There's my most amazing script ever. We probably should change that to module. What do you think? Rename using the old DOS thing there. So we got ./most to ./... most, there we go, most amazing, oh, I better get the right file, PSM1, I'm going to call this most amazing module ever. All right, dir*.psm1. Now I'm going to, you ready for this? Does anybody know the commandlet to import a module? You're catching on quick. import-module./. This means don't go browsing through all the paths all over my drive. Pull it out of my current folder. Most amazing module ever, PSM1. All right, so I've just done an import module. Now I'm going to type get command, because that's the next question is, I've imported a module, what did I get? And if I scroll way back to the top of this get command, somewhere in here is get uptime. Where'd it go?
Can you do a search?
All right, so let's try it. Get-uptime, CVDC1. It works. I've imported the command list, but let's say get command dash, oh, here's what I want to do. Sorry. Get dash module. That's going to show me the modules that have been imported. And I can see it's called a script module because it's based on a PowerShell script. And there's the most amazing module ever. Now I'm going to do copy. Get command dash module. Paste. Whoa. Scrolled. Get command dash module. Right click. There it is. Get command on the module shows me the commandlets that are available. Get dash valid computer name. So now I can type things like help get dash valid computer name, tab complete, it works. There's my help. Actually, I didn't document that one well enough. Let's do a help on get dash uptime. There it is. There's my help. All right, good. So it looks like a real commandlet. It acts like a real commandlet. And all it was a PSM1 file. That's it. I just rip out the calling code, save it with a PSM1, and I've got a module now. There's a little bit more to it.
And that lives for the entire operating system until you uninstall the module.
Right. We haven't really installed it. We just referenced the file directly. There's a better place to stick it where it will automatically see the module. And that's what we want to do next.
Okay.
There's a special environment variable here, PS module path, and I'm going to split this on the semicolon so you can see the two paths here. Modules in PowerShell are usually in one of these two folders. There's another one for PowerShell version 4, but usually you're going to see them under the user folder under Windows PowerShell modules or under the System32, and that's where all your built-in system modules are located. So here's why you need to know this. In PowerShell version 3, we introduced a new feature called background module loading. So I don't even have to type import module. I can just type get dash uptime, and as long as it can find a module in one of these paths with the command get dash uptime, it will just import it automatically for me. Nice. So I don't even have to type import module if I stick it in one of these paths. So let's do that. Now, again, I'm going to cheat. I'm going to show you my big secret. Help get about modules. I'm so lazy I do this every time. It's too much typing. About modules show window. And I'm going to scroll down. I've read this before. You're going to go home and read it, so you'll see it later. Down under here, there's a line right here. Create a module directory, type this. It even tells you exactly what to type. New item, directory, path. It's going to create that whole Windows PowerShell modules folder. And then I have to create a My Module folder underneath there and then copy it into that path. So what I'm going to do is copy this little snippet right here out of the help. I'm copying straight out of help. Okay, that shouldn't even be legal. But I'm doing it right here. And I'm going to put right here, most amazing module ever. I just now created a folder. The parent folders did not exist. It created the whole path all in one swipe. So now I've got to put my file in that folder. So what I'm going to do then is, again, I'm lazy. I'm going to copy that whole path. I know I missed the character on the end. *.psm1. And so I'm going to type move item, or just move, ./ most amazing module ever. And I'm going to paste in that path that I just created. Just to show you where it went, let's go look. Documents, Windows PowerShell, modules, most amazing module ever, most amazing module ever. There it is, PSM1. So all I did was read the help and copy and paste. There's no magic. All right, read the help, copy and paste. Now I have a really cool trick. Now I'm going to come down here. I've just launched a brand new, fresh session. Now cross your fingers. I could have done something wrong. If I did this right, I can type get dash what? Valid computer name? Dash valid. Tab complete works on the function that I just put in a module, following exactly and pasting from the help. Now, I hit enter. Name a machine to target, ASDF. I'm going to get it this time. It's timing out. Nope. Let's do it again. CVDC1. And now we've returned CVDC1. Look at that. I didn't type import module or anything. I just went into the help. I read about modules. I created a folder copying the code that it had for me, which made a module folder. I put my functions in there. Touchdown, Seahawks. All right. Nice. Wow. What's left after that? What's left after that? We've done it, right? I'm not going to do that. So to cut to the Bobby Flay big finale here, this is the whole module file. Oh, no, there is one other thing. I am sorry. We got to put one other thing in there if we really, really, really want to make this fancy. Let's close a couple of these windows here. So I'm going to now change into that directory. And there's my module file in that really crazy, long, obscenely long file path. And I'm going to do this. New dash module manifest. And I'm going to give it the path here. Most amazing module ever.psd1. Now, I'm running short on time. Just to tell you, I looked that up in about underscore modules or the help on new dash module manifest. Together, reading those two pieces of text on the screen, it told me how to do this. So now I'm created a new module manifest file, and I've got two files in there. And if I launch that in the ISE, this is what it says, generated by administrator. Here's a root module. This is the one thing I must change right here. ./ most, if I can spell, most amazing module ever .psm1. And I'm version 1.0. Author is going to be Mr. Ashley McGlone, Goatee PFE. Company is Coho Vineyard. That's one of those other fake company names. And anyway, description, PowerShell version. I can go through and set a bunch of prerequisites for my module. So if, let's say, I do AD, so maybe I want the AD module to be imported and present before you can import mine. So I can put in there a required PowerShell module that must be installed first. I can put some required modules, all kinds of other things, .NET version, PowerShell version. Right down here, I can, let's say I don't want to export all the functions in that module. Maybe I've got some helper functions that I don't want to show up when somebody looks at it, and they just need to stay in the background. I can just give it a list right here to say only export these functions and hide the rest. And so for now, I'm just going to save this and come out here to a fresh, clean console and type get module list available. And what that does is says, go look through those module paths we looked at earlier and give me a list of all the possible modules on my machine. And when I scroll up the list, you'll see, oh, look at that. It found it right under there. Under PowerShell modules, most amazing module ever, it found it. So let's just be blatant here. Import module, most amazing. Tab complete even works. Can't believe it. Wow. So now I've got get dash valid computer name, but I don't really care about that. I want to do a get module. There it is. I've imported the module. Get module, most amazing module ever. And I want to look at a format list star so you can see when I look at the header data now for that module, there it is, version, author, company, all that metadata that I put in about the module is now tracked in the properties of that module in the background automatically with PowerShell. Now there's nothing left. All right. So, what are you going to do when you get back to work on Monday? Besides answer email, what are you going to put in a function? What are you going to put in a module? What can you do with this? Write it down right now, because I know since I've slept the night before, I'm not going to remember. Write it down right now and make yourself a note to go look at that note. And then in the morning on Monday, you say, this is what I can do with PowerShell now. Because that guy showed me in less than 2 hours, he had a whole module running with all kinds of fancy stuff. So you can do it. That's what I started out at the beginning of this session to say. I want to move you from copy and paste scripting to I can do this scripting. All right? How many feel a little bit better about PowerShell now? Fantastic. Look at all those hands. Great. You make me happy. Very good. So let's wrap things up here. We'll have a few minutes for questions if I can stop talking. So PowerShell scripting process then. We have gone from an idea, a problem. Somebody says there's got to be a better way. And we found a better way using PowerShell. Then we what did we use to find the commandlets that we needed?
Help.
Help. What else? Show command, get command. All right. Very good. We also used some WMI-related commandlets. What were those? Get WMI object. And what were the newer ones? Sim, the sim commandlets. Get sim instance, get sim class. You guys paid attention. Good. And then we got the pipeline. So now I've got some data, input, process, output, format left, or filter left, format right. There's a motto, filter left, format right. So that's what we did then. We structured our pipeline in such a way to get exactly what we needed for that last patch installed. Then we moved it on to a script. We took those lines out of the console. I've done a lot of copying and pasting of my own typing here, not somebody else's code, right? So just copy and paste that into the ISE and save it as a PS1, and I got a script now. Touchdown, Seahawks. All right. So then we got a script. We move it into a function. We now take these commands that are just kind of strung together, spaghetti code, one long file. We break it up and organize it into functions that we can call. What was the commandlet that we used to figure out a possible name?
Get-verb.
You guys are doing great. All right, so get-verb gives me a list of suggested PowerShell function verbs to start out with. And then I put some, what else did I put in that function?
Documentation,
that's right. Documentation. Finally, we got a module. What was the difference in the file extension with the module? PSM1. And what was the difference in the file itself? I took out the calling code at the bottom. Right. So I just left the functions at the top, save it as PSM1, and I won't say it again. All right. Now, you do that a couple of times, and that is going to make you a PowerShell hero. That's right. Fantastic. Just do this. Give yourself a big pat on the back right there. Come on. You do it. Yeah, you can reach back there. Pat on the back. All right. Good job. This is good. I want to see some emails from you guys. Say, hey, you look, this really worked for me. I'm a hero. All right. So scripting lifecycle then. Write, test, debug. We do that over and over. Write, test, debug. Then we did a little bit of this stuff in the middle of making it friendly. We added some comments, some help, documentation. We still need to do some error handling and some logging so that we've got some recourse if something goes wrong. And then finally, we're going to publish that. Now that we've got a module file in that little folder, we can take that and put it out on the network somewhere and point our other people on the team, say, just go copy these files. You could even write a little script. I know Ed's got one on his blog that is like install-module. And you can even write something like that for them that creates the little module folder, sticks the files in there, and then runs it. Or they could just import it straight from the network share. You got your pick.
Can you point to modules on network share?
Yeah. Yep.
You don't have to import them. I mean, you don't have to copy them down at all.
Right. You don't have to copy them down, but okay. It just depends on how you want to do it. Yep. Then, so we've updated it. Now we've got that version number in there in the module manifest. So we can see there's where I've changed from 1.0 to 1.1. And then support, I wish I could erase that last bullet. They're going to call you. You say, read the help. That's what I put it in there for. Unless you didn't, if you didn't put the help, you deserve that phone call. All right. Put your documentation in there. It's just, what was the shortcut key to drop the help in? Control J. I am pleased. You all have paid attention. You've learned. This is great. I'm excited about what you're going to do when you get back to work. So here are some resources, the same one from the last session. If you'd like a copy of these sample scripts, you can go out to aka.ms/gotpfe, and they're at the top of the list today, right there waiting for you, PowerShell Saturday 007 in Charlotte. You can download all the scripts and all the slides as well. Free training on Microsoft Virtual Academy. So if we were to compare these free sessions out there to what we just did, session one this morning was getting started with PowerShell, just doing the basics, okay? A lot more to it, but then advanced tools and scripting, that's where you create functions and modules. So if you'd like to learn more about what we just did in this brief conference session, you can go out here and watch a full one day of training on each of those topics from Jeffrey Snover and Jason Helmick. Finally, Ed has some books right here. PowerShell First Steps, Here's the Best Practices. I don't have a copy of Step by Step, but these are Ed's books. Ed Wilson, Microsoft scripting guy. If you haven't met Ed while you're here today, make sure to go shake his hand and tell him that you read his blog. That'll make him happy. All right. How do you get your hands on one of those? Which one?
First Steps.
Both?
Step Best Practice.
First Steps, there you go.
Awesome, thank you.
All right. All right. Ed's got, they told me I had to save some for Ed to give away. So there are a few extra copies for Ed to give away later. All right. So those are your resources. And we have 5 minutes for questions. So just sit tight and let's do questions. Yes.
Your module 10 or demo 10 here. Yeah.
Okay.
Red lines on it here when I try to run it.
Red letters, red text. That means you're not Chuck Norris.
Exactly.
All right.
For test dash path.
Something's not right in the folder. This means.
All right. There's probably surface not return result return time of day. Tell you what, let's look at it after the session. But yeah, I'm not Chuck Norris either. All right. It'll get you close. Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
When you showed the modules are loaded, someone said like had a nice formalized namespace, Microsoft, PowerShell, et cetera, and the one that you made didn't have any of that. Is there anything special that needs to be done? We want to put in our corporate.
So the question. Namespace? All right. So the question is, on these namespaces on the module. So over here, when I type get module list. There are these oddball ones right here in the middle. You got time for a story?
Sure.
So in PowerShell version 2, how many of you use PowerShell version 2? All right, a bunch of people. You click the blue PowerShell console icon, and then what do? You wait, that's right. You wait in PowerShell version 2 for it to import each one of these modules in the background. But what we did in PowerShell 3 was we decided, you know, we don't like that wait time either. Why don't we just load, well, backtrack. There's something called snap-ins in PowerShell version 1. They're still there, but snap-ins are ways to add commands to your session. PowerShell version 2, we introduced this concept of modules. Well, these were all snap-ins that were automatically loaded when you launched the session in version 2. In version 3, we took these and converted them to modules, and now as modules, they're only loaded in the background automatically when they're needed. So that means your shell loads faster. There's a bunch of other things that make it load faster too, but that's a big part of it. So do you want to create a dotted name for your module? You can. It's just the only thing. The only reason these look funny like that with the dotted names is we made them. We like long names, but you know, if you want to do that, you can. You can just put it in the name of the file.
From an organizational perspective in a big company, if we're going to have our company dot help desk dot exchange team, or how we're going to organize all of our own modules.
That might not be
a recommended way to do it, or is there a better way? Or
that sounds like a great idea. Just create your own namespace for a hierarchy of your modules. That might be a good way to organize them.
But is that a property of the module itself?
It's just the name.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Just think.
Well, I have a question that relates to that.
Okay.
I work for a company that we do consulting for some big clients in the Charlotte area. My clients have to have hundreds, if not thousands, of their own clients in the finance industry, banking, investing. If I have a module, say, that's a goatee guy, and another one that says almost a bald guy, I secure these so that either one can talk to each other in any way, shape, or form?
No. So, not that I'm aware of. I mean, if they're going to be on the same box, they can see each other.
Same infrastructure in some cases.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I think we're just about out of time. One more question. PSD is PowerShell data file. And I'm glad you asked. Let's go take a look at that file again real quick. Back in the ISC here, I want you to notice something special about the top of this file right here. What is this PSD file extension? Well, it's a PowerShell data file, and it starts out with a at sign and a curly brace. And it's a hash table, right? So it's like an old style INI file, except it's in a PowerShell hash table format. So that's what this manifest file format is. It's actually a hash table. And we use that in other types of PowerShell files. This is the only one that we really call PSD1, though.
It's a hash table.
Yep, it's a hash table.
What is that?
A hash table?
Yeah.
It's a dictionary object. What's a dictionary object? Well, what it is...
It's a hash table.
So a hash table is like an array, where you can have multiple compartments inside a single variable, except instead of using numbers to index that array, you can, but you can also use strings. So I can give names to values, keys and values we call them, and that's a hash table. And guess what? There's an about underscore hash tables help topic. Tells you even more. Yep. Okay, we're out of time. Thank you all for making this a great PowerShell Saturday.